Hello everyone, good morning, good evening. I hope all of you are staying safe. My name is Asit and welcome to Citrix ADM Service monthly webinar. We are in June month's webinar. Today is June 24th. I'm the host and the panelist. My name is Asit. I have with me Sayukta, who will be covering Citrix ADM Service Security Advisory. It's a very interesting feature using which you can remediate the recent CVEs which Citrix published a bulletin about. So without further ado, let's get started. This is the agenda. We will start with the overview of ADM service. I'll briefly touch upon the built-in agent of onboarding. And then I'll hand over the control to Sayukta, who will talk about how you can remediate, identify and remediate the recent CVEs 2020-8299 and 2020-8300. And then we'll see some real app analytics use cases which you can benefit from. As we know, we can jumpstart to ADM service in three quick steps. It's very easy to onboard your ADC to ADM service using these three quick steps. The first step would be to create an account in Citrix Cloud. Some of you might be already having an account in Citrix Cloud, in which case you just need to sign in. After signing in, you get various methods to add your agent. You can add your agent on an on-premise hypervisor. You can add your agent on a public cloud, or you can use the built-in agent method of onboarding. So the built-in agent is a script which has been packaged with your ADC build 12.056.20 onwards. You just need to call the script of the built-in agent from the ADC after logging into the ADC, and you pass the admin credentials of the ADC and the service URL and the activation code as input to the script. The service URL and the activation code is available on the ADM service GUI, which you can copy and pass as a parameter to the script. So it seems some of you are aware and some of you are not aware about the CVE. So don't worry, Sayukta will cover in more details about what is the CVE, how you can remediate and identify it. Over to you, Sayukta.
Thank you, Asit. Hi everyone, this is Sayukta from the ADM product management team. And today I'll be taking you through a security advisory. I believe we've covered this feature in the webinar of I think 2 months back, but we'll be doing a quick relook at it, and especially in context of the recently launched CVEs, so that you can leverage it to identify what is the impact of the latest CVEs on your environment and how you can remediate it. So let's get started. Now, how is the security advisory going to help you if you're an existing ADM service customer? Now, as you know, Citrix strives to keep its products up to date and free from any vulnerabilities. However, at times there are cases where our products are vulnerable, and we call that out and highlight it by releasing a security bulletin in which we share details of the CVE, how you can identify it, and how you can remediate it. However, the process of reading the security bulletin and applying it to identify the impact on your deployment and remediate it remains a manual chore. So this is something which we saw as a pain point, and we thought, why not have ADM help with this use case? With that in mind, we've launched security advisory. Do take a note that security advisory does not require any additional license. So even if you're an express customer on an ADM service, you can make use of this feature. So what a security advisory helps you with? It'll help you with assessing your security posture. We have two forms of scans which we perform depending on the kind of CVE which is needed. Some CVEs, you need to check the version of the ADC versus the version of the fixed build for that CVE, and accordingly identify whether the ADC is vulnerable or not. That is referred to as version scan. And in some CVEs which are not only requiring version scan, they also need us to look into the ADC's configuration to understand whether the ADC is vulnerable or not. That's referred to as config scan. So as required by the CVE, ADM service will use both of these to tell you whether your ADC is vulnerable or not. We run a system-wide scan across all your instances once every week to give you an updated security posture. But if you want to run it on demand as well in between any time, you can do that with a scan now option. We call that the on demand scan. Now, this security advisory will help you understand your vulnerable ADCs. You can understand it in two ways. If you want to know a specific CVE is impacting how many ADCs. You can see that. On the reverse side, if you want to know one ADC is impacted by how many CVEs and which CVEs, you can understand that as well. Once you've seen this identification of vulnerable ADCs, you can go forward, look at the remediation and do the remediation from ADM service. As many of you would be knowing, most of the CVEs require an upgrade for remediation, and ADM service has a very seamless, automated and customized way of upgrading ADM ADC instances. So you can go ahead and upgrade. Some CVE, for example, the latest CVE 8300 requires you to execute some config commands as well after you upgrade for complete remediation. For this kind of CVE, we have a base config template also, which will help you with the complete remediation. We'll look at this a little more in detail as I talk about the latest CVE in the upcoming slides. Last but not the least, we want Security Advisory to help you get complete details on all the CVEs which are in its scope. And you can look at the last 5 scan reports also to understand how your security posture has changed based on the actions you would have done. So with that quick intro, I'll go to the demo. Just a quick recap of what all benefits you will get if you upgrade ADC via ADM service. This has a lot of benefits. You can upgrade any type of ADC. You can upgrade them parallelly. You can take a backup of the config before upgrading. You can schedule the upgrade. You can have 2-stage upgrades, which means that you can upgrade one node in HA, take a pause, do some checks, and then upgrade the second. That can also be automated. ADM also does some pre-upgrade checks to ensure that whatever things are going to lead to a sure shot ADC upgrade failure are highlighted to you upfront, and you can correct them. It'll take care of a lot of other things also. I'm not going to go into these details because we've covered it in previous webinar. You can find more details on this in our documentation. We also have a YouTube video to show you how ADC can be upgraded via ADM, which you can look at. Now I'll move on to the security advisory demo. So if you log into your Citrix ADM service, you will find a node called Instance Advisory under Networks that will be having security advisory. So once you click on security advisory, you will see that the last scan has happened at a specific date. Next system scan is planned after a week. So you'll see that date as well. If you want to do an on-demand scan, you can hit the scan now button and it will take a couple of minutes to run the scan again for your deployment and give you the latest posture as of today, as of that time. Do take a note that if you run this scan, it's not going to impact your ADC in terms of resource utilization, config, traffic, nothing. So you can safely run it. Now, to understand the impact of your CVEs on your ADC instances, you can look at the first tab, which will be open by default. Here you can see 4 CVEs are impacting your deployment, and in total, 6 ADCs are impacted by the CVEs. So when you scroll here, you can see the 4 CVEs which are impacting. Now, let me talk about the latest CVE. So many of you were not aware of the latest security bulletin, which was released by Citrix on June 8th. So before talking about this, I'll take you to the CVE repository tab. This repository has the details of all the CVEs starting from December 2019 onwards, which is what security advisory has in its scope. You can see that 2 new CVEs has been released on June 8th. So this CVE, CVE 2020-8299, also got released on June 8th. And CVE 2020-8300 also got released on June 8th. You can sort it by publication date as well if you want to look at it that way. And both the CVEs details are given here, what kind of CVE it is, what severity it is at. One is medium, the other is high. The remediation also will be provided to you. You can see that 8299 is a CVE which is a one-step remediation CVE. You just have to upgrade the ADCs to remediate it. However, 8300 CVE is a little more complicated and you need to have a 2-step process to remediate it. That is, you have to upgrade and apply a config job to it. That is a set of commands to it. Now, there is a bulletin link given here. You can click on it and read that bulletin to know more details about both of these CVEs. Now, this is about having information on the CVE, but to know the impact, we go back to the current CVE tab. Here I see that out of the 2 new CVEs, 8299 CV is impacting my ADCs. 8300 isn't, because 8300 is a CV which impacts ADCs and gateways if you have SAML configured. You can look into more details in the bulletin, but it's not impacting my ADCs as of now. So first I will take you through how you can remediate 8299 CV. So you can see the CV is impacting six of my ADCs, and I need to upgrade my vulnerable ADCs to the release mentioned as the remediation. So I click on this CVE, and of course you can click on other CVEs also if you want to remediate all of them. So you can select all also and proceed. For now, let me just select one and go to view affected instances. Here you will see that it's come to the second card. It's filtered my instances based on the CV which I selected in the first step. And these are the ADCs which are impacted. I'll select all of them and proceed to the upgrade workflow. This will get you to the familiar upgrade workflow. Many of you would already be knowing it. You simply need to give this a name and proceed to the next steps, which will do the pre-validation upgrade. If you want the optional step to execute some scripts pre and post upgrade to do some analysis, you can do that. You say you want to upgrade now or schedule it in your maintenance window and create the job. So I'm not going through each of these steps. We have seen it earlier. So that is, you know, a simple way in which you can remediate 8299 CVE. Now I will talk about the other CV, which is 8300. I don't have it impacting this deployment of mine, but I have a video to show you details on it. So Seek Security Advisory now supports both of these. So I just showed you that a CV repository tab will reflect it. And now let's look at a video to remediate 8300. Now, I believe most of you are customers who are already using ADM service, but if some of you have not onboarded as yet to ADM service and you are an ADC customer who's not yet basically using ADM service, you can still get this security advisory insights at a you know, reduced down level to some extent with our initiative ADM service connect-based low touch onboarding. I've covered this in previous webinar, but again, to give a quick recap of this, this initiative was launched to help enable a true controller-led vision. ADCs which are on latest versions, that is 12.157.x and 13.061.x onwards, are auto-connected to ADM service with the help of ADM Service Connect feature and Call Home feature. So ADM Service Connect features enabled on the releases and builds, which I just mentioned, and Call Home you would already be aware of. It is enabled since, I believe, quite some time now. So if any of these features are enabled on your ADCs, they will be auto-connected to ADM Service and will be sending ADM Service some limited metrics and events. Based on that, we create an inventory for you. To let you know which are the ADCs and gateways belonging to you, and we create some insights on them. These insights also include security advisory insights. I will show you how they look like. So how do we share these insights with you? The product, which is ADM service itself, starts an email. It sends you a product initiated email with these insights, and then you can get started, come to the product. And once you feel that ADM is giving you value, you can choose to onboard these ADCs onto ADM service. The onboarding is also aided with an automated and seamless workflow so that you have to take minimal efforts to onboard these ADCs. I'll now show you how it would look like for you. So again, to repeat, this workflow is for customers who've not yet onboarded. So this is the email you would get if you, you know, if or your ADCs have any of those two features enabled, which is ADM Service Connect and Call Home. You'll see that we give you some insights on your ADCs and gateways. Security advisory tells you how many ADCs are on versions which have known CVEs. Along with this advisory, some other insights are also there, like upgrade advisory telling you how many of your ADCs are reaching or have reached end of life or end of maintenance, how many ADCs have got some critical events on them, etc. You can click on the Get Started button, which will take you to Citrix Cloud login page. You can sign in. This gets you to our landing page, which explains to you that your ADCs and gateways are auto-connected to us, sending us some limited metrics, but they are not yet onboarded onto ADM service. And to onboard them, you would need to follow this step-by-step onboarding flow. You can click on Next. The next button will give you some more insights into your ADC and gateway deployment, similar to what you'd seen on email, but a little more detailed. The thought process behind giving you these details is to show you the value that ADM can offer even with very limited metrics. And the suggestion is to onboard onto ADM to make advantage of the full-blown features. For example, security advisory here just tells you based on version scan how many ADCs can be vulnerable. But to get a more up-to-date and conclusive report, you need to onboard your ADCs. Also, to take the remediation actions, which I just demoed to you, you would need to onboard. Similarly, for upgrade advisory, also we show you some information and the recommendation is to onboard. So and so forth for the other cards. Proceeding to the next step, you'll get a complete inventory list showing you which all ADCs and gateways are in your deployment. You can select which instances you want to onboard. And once you select them, you come to the last step, which is the onboarding step. This step is pre-filled with whatever information we can. For example, we've pre-filled it with built-in agent, which is the fastest way to get started for managing and monitoring your ADCs. You can change it to external agent if you want to. I've selected 18 instances in my previous step to onboard. Now, all I need to do in this step is give the ADM a username and password of the ADC which I want to onboard. Note that this should be the username and password of a super user. ADM will use this username and password to authenticate and onboard the ADCs. Once you provide this, you can do start auto onboarding. And ADM will take care of onboarding these instances onto ADM service. Nothing more is needed from your end. So you see that 10 instances out of my 18 are compatible with automatic onboarding, which is going to happen seamlessly. However, some of my ADCs are on older versions and would require a semi-manual kind of onboarding, which we call as the script-based onboarding. So for this, you can either use a script or you can execute CLI commands on each ADC to onboard, whichever you find more comfortable. In the script-based approach, you simply need to download the script, put it on any one of the ADCs which is network connected to the others, and run this command. So the script will initiate the built-in agent on all of the ADCs and have them onboarded onto ADM service. That's all you need to do, and then you can proceed to ADM to see the ADC instances onboarded in your instance management page. So if you meet these three prerequisites, that is if you have your ADCs internet connected, if you have any of these two features enabled, ADM Service Connect or Call Home, and if you have a Citrix Cloud account, you will get this email which I just showed you, and you can leverage this workflow to onboard onto ADM service. So you can have a look at our documentation. I've given the links towards the end of the deck as well to read more about this initiative. Now, a couple of additional points to note on security advisory. And the scans, as I mentioned, are not going to impact your ADC instance config or traffic. Do not worry about that. The scope of security advisory is that in the product itself, that is the main security advisory feature in ADM service, we will cover version-based scan and config-based scan as applicable for the CVE. In the email workflow, which I showed you, which is for non-ADM service customers, that is if you've not yet onboarded, this security advisory insights will only have version-based scans. So only based on the version of your CVE, we will tell you the vulnerable possibilities. To know more conclusive details, you'll have to onboard and see the full-blown security advisory feature. Now, for version scan, how do we identify whether your ADC is vulnerable? If a particular CVE is fixed on release XX.YY, all the builds below that release are considered vulnerable. So ADM service uses this logic and marks the ADCs as vulnerable for the CVEs which need version scan. Do take a note on the scope that this is applicable to all the ADCs and gateways which are on main releases and builds. But we do not take care of special builds like SSP builds, FIPS, NDCPP, hot fixes, etc. Those are not in security advisory scope as of now. Similarly, admin partitions, SD-WANs, HAProxy are not in scope. And your ADC instances would need to be on versions 11.0 and above for leveraging security advisory. Security advisory covers all CVEs published by Citrix starting from December 2019 onwards. You can see the list of these CVs in the CV repository tab in Security Advisory. So that's all. I have some more details on ADM Service Connect feature, which I spoke about for the workflow. You can have a look in the documentation as well for this. You know, what types of form factors or types of ADCs it covers. You can have a look at the data governance documents and the URLs which you need to put in your allowed list for the connectivity to happen. Here are some of the documents, blogs, and videos for Security Advisory which can help you leverage this feature. And this is about the workflow which I spoke of, ADM Service Connect based low touch onboarding. I will ping these links on the chat window as well for you to leverage them. And that's all I had for today. Thank you so much for joining, and I'll now hand over to Asit, who will be covering the app analytics section of today's webinar. Thank you.
All right, let's move on to the second part of the webinar. So let's try to understand which are the different analytics use cases that you can use in ADM service. We have now app performance analytics for helping you identify which are the slower apps in your enterprise. So you might be managing several different applications. So it will help you identify and pinpoint which application's response time is becoming anomalous and identify the contributing factor as well for the anomalous response time. Underneath, it uses a machine learning model which uses a pattern recognition to understand the baseline behavior of the response time and highlights anomalies. When it comes to app server availability, we had a server response time with anomalous servers with anomalous response time use case, which was again an ML based use case. This had been there for quite some time, and we have now newer additions to the app server availability use cases. We have 5xx errors. You can get details of all the 5xx errors on ADM service using web transaction analytics. You can identify any kind of search queue buildup which might have happened in front of your virtual servers or using a search queue buildup indicator on the app dashboard on ADM service. Recently, we introduced the monitor health status, using which you can see all the monitors which are bound to services or the service groups and their health statistics, like how many probes they have sent, total number of failed probes, whether the monitor is in up or down state, what was the last response from the monitor. We have a use case on app maintenance analytics, which helps you to find out the top 5 lean usage period of your applications. So traditionally, app owners, they take maintenance of their applications based on hunch, or they follow the best practices of what other app owners do. But we have real analytics data based on the lean usage of the application, which can help you to find top 5 lean usage of your application, and you can likewise take app maintenance decisions using the data. We have app peak usage, which helps you to assess and differentiate the peak usage of your application from the average usage. So the average usage kind of subsumes the peak usage of your application. It is difficult to find out what is the actual peak usage happening in your application. We give, with app peak usage analytics, clear visibility into the peak usage of the application's usage, and using which you can put appropriate rate limits based on the peak usage. For app usage insights, we have a use case which uses machine learning again to find out applications with anomalous usage behavior in terms of request, throughput, data volume, SSL parameters. And these applications which have anomalous usage behavior, we can understand how frequently the usage is becoming anomalous, with how volatile is the application, and they become good candidate for moving to flexible workloads like public cloud, auto scale, and taking advantage of pool licensing. We also help you to identify app usage trends, understanding the top clients, browsers, OS, geographies, URLs, HTTP responses for your applications, as well as SSL metrics, load time, and render time. For app SSL analytics, we recently introduced a feature using which you can assess if your application is A+ or not as per the Qualys SSL labs, and it gives you a quick way to deploy the A+ configuration on your application. We have other SSL parameters, optimization parameters available on the app dashboard. App SSL optimization, which helps you to optimize various SSL parameters on the ADC. SSL session buildup, which helps you to identify any kind of session buildup which might have happened on the ADC and consuming memory in the ADC. We also help you to identify all the bound certificates to your application. You can see that information on the ADM app dashboard and see which are the certificates bound to your application. You can also see details of any expired certificates, certificates which do not have enterprise mandated ciphers, protocols, and keys. And you can get visibility around applications whose certificates do not adhere to these enterprise policies. Just to take a note that you define these enterprise policies of your SSL configuration in your SSL dashboard, where you can define recommended protocols, keys, and ciphers which are allowed at enterprise wide. And any deviation from that is now highlighted in the ADM app dashboard. And lastly, on the SSL certificate lifecycle management, we have WinAFI integration using which you can issue and renew your certificates by creating a certificate signing request from the app dashboard. And if you have configured the WinAFI server, it will trigger a workflow to the WinAFI server, get a certificate issued, as well as you can install it on the ADC. All these steps can also be automated with few settings. And finally, app resource analytics, which helps identify any kind of high CPU usage on the ADC, high memory usage on the ADC, as well as high application CPU usage on the ADC, if any specific application is consuming high memory on the ADC. So let's try to understand the first use case, which is around app slowness root cause analysis. The challenge is to find out which application is slower when you have a multitude of different enterprise applications being managed, and the network and app admins are constantly having this tussle of finding where is the problem. Is it at the network side, at the server latency side, or is it the backend server which is taking more time for processing, or the clients are having a lag at their end? So this is what this use case helps solve. It gives you clear identification to find out all slower apps and factors contributing to slowness, like client network latency, server network latency, and server processing time. It gives clear remediation guidance post the root cause analysis. ADM service has specific features like pointing to the exact factor of slowness, getting details of all slower app transactions, getting recommendation to mitigate slowness. Now let's try to understand a bit around the methodology and the algorithm used for this. We're using the box plot methodology. So consider that you have different data points of your application's response time. So all this is plotted in a box plot, whereas Q1 indicates the first quartile of the response time. Q3 is the third quartile. It defines the minimum value as Q1 minus 1.5 times into interquartile range. So the difference between third quartile and first quartile is the interquartile range, and Q1 minus 1.5 times into interquartile range is the minimum. Similarly, Q3 plus 1.5 times into interquartile range is the maximum. And anything which falls outside the minimum and the maximum value is an outlier. This is a very famous and well-known methodology of finding outliers for any kind of data point distribution. So we find the upper limit for the application's response time. We find client network latency upper limit, server network latency upper limit, and server processing time upper limit. Then we see which whenever any application's response time is higher than the upper limit of the application's response time, we highlight such apps. And then we debug whether the client network latency is higher than the client network latency upper limit, then that becomes the contributing factor. Similarly, if the server network latency is higher than the server network latency upper limit, that becomes the contributing factor, and likewise for server processing time. To understand this with an example, let's say there is an application which has a first quartile response time of 10 milliseconds, a third quartile response time of 15 milliseconds, and an interquartile range of 5 milliseconds. So the minimum value turns out to be 10 minus 1.5 into IQR, which is 2.5 milliseconds, and the maximum value is 22.5 milliseconds. And anything which falls outside this will be classified as an outlier. I have the app response time as 25 milliseconds, which is outside the maximum value, and therefore it is an outlier. Let's have a small demo of this. So this is my ADM service GUI. So under applications, I have web insights. When I click on web insights and I can select any duration, let's say I'm selecting 1 month duration, I'm seeing the different applications with response time anomalies. So I have a ADP IP application, which has 1400 plus anomalies. And however, I will see that out of the 1,405 anomalies, two anomalies are contributed by client network latency and the rest are contributed by server processing time. So it clearly brings out that the dominating factor is the server processing time for the response time anomaly. It gives the range of the expected range of the response time for this application, which is between 1 millisecond to 6 milliseconds. And there has been an instance of response time being in the range of 248 milliseconds. So let's click on this application and see what's happening with this particular application. On the top, we can see the average value of response time, average value of client network latency, server network latency, and server processing time. We can see that their overall out of the 1400 plus instances of response time anomalies, it is predominantly dominated by the server processing time. Let's see the two instances where client network latency was the contributing factor. So I click on that, and I will see in red highlighted the two instances where client network latency was the contributing factor. And when I click on that, below I am seeing that the date and time in which the client network latency was the contributing factor. I'm seeing that the client network latency is 7 milliseconds, which is 180% more than the expected range. Similarly, I will go to the server processing time. Server network latency doesn't have any instance, as we can see on the top summary as well. When I go to the server processing time, I am seeing a continuous red lines, which indicates the different instances where server processing time was the culprit. Below, I see the different timestamp and anomaly details. Here, the first instance, the server processing time is 23 milliseconds, which is 37% more than the expected range. I get the server IP address as well. If we scroll down below, it gives some recommended action. It is telling to change the LB algorithm to least response time. And we can also see if there is any kind of search queue buildup happened on the service. And we can also gracefully disable the service. So this is giving a couple of recommendations over here. And because it is giving us the server IP address, so we can avoid the finger pointing. We know that the server processing time is the contributing factor and which is the exact server. And then you can go and debug the issue. Let's go to the second use case. So ADM now helps you to assess the health of your bound monitors to app service. So it will help you to understand which are the different type of monitors which are bound and if any of the monitor is in up or down state. So we can define different type of monitors for ping, for TCP, HTTP, for even for database level monitors as well. And gives statistics like total probes, failed probes, current probes, as well as details of the last probe response. So let's see this with a quick demo of how you can find the monitors bound monitor status on ADM service. For this, you'll have to go to the applications app dashboard. Let's say I click on one particular application, which is my finance portal. On the top right of this application, I have the services tab. When I click on it, I'll see the details of all the bound service for every virtual servers. So I have the FP2 virtual server and it has one service, which is an upstate. When I click on this service, I will get the details of the service name and the protocol state of the service. And if I checkbox this service and I click on bound monitors, I'll see the details of the different bound monitors. Here it has one bound monitor, which is in upstate, and it gives me details of total probes, failed probes, current failed probes, and the last response. So that's how you can see details of all bound monitors on ADM service. Let's move to the third use case, which is around evaluating all 5xx errors from app servers. So 5xx errors indicates either the server is overloaded or it is unavailable, which can lead to an error of the application being unavailable to the end user. Web transaction analytics helps you get detailed visibility into all the 5xx errors. So it gives complete connection visibility, end-to-end picture of a connection right from client to the ADC to the backend server. It helps you understand what is the RTT at each leg of the transaction. It has extensive searchability parameters. You can search by various combination of filter criteria and search criteria as well. Finally, you can segregate the logs over role-based access control. ADM offers very granular role-based access controls using which you can do segregation. And this is linked to ADM app performance, so you can find detailed transaction logs. So let's see how this looks on ADM service. For this, again, you can go to the ADM app dashboard. You can select any particular application. And again, on the top right, we have this transaction logs. So the moment I select the transaction logs, I will get details of all the different transaction logs. So it gives all 5xx errors and some sample 2xx success criteria as well. So let me select the 5xx errors as well, because that's what I'm interested in. Once I select the 5xx error, I get details distribution of the 5xx error on a timeline chart. Let me use the filter criteria on the top and narrow down the search result further. So let's say I want to filter only for client IP 172.16.10.51, and I will do a search. So this will filter only for that specific client IP, how many 5xx error we are getting. We get the details below. And let's say this is my frequent search criteria. I can save the search as well and name it client IP, and let's say search. So this search query will be saved, and I can come back and reuse it in the future as well. Below, when we see the details of the different 5xx transactions, so this is the granular end-to-end picture. So we can see the client-side activity from the client to the Citrix ADC, and from Citrix ADC to server, how much is the ATT. We get the start time and end time with the transaction, the OS, the browser and device details, SSL details like front end failure, cipher, keystring, etc. We have ADC IP address, virtual server IP address as well, virtual server details as well. We have backend server and total bytes consumed and the response as well. So this is how, this is a lot of information that we get to help us start with the debugging process for all the 5xx error. And this is what a web transaction analytics helps you with. Let's now move to the fourth use case, which is around app maintenance analytics. So let's say there is an app owner who is Adam. He's the app owner SharePoint application, and he's contemplating the maintenance of his application. He's interested to find out which is the most lean usage period during which he can take his app down for maintenance. He has been also speaking to other admins. So he's thinking whether he should use the best practices which other app admins follow, or he should just use his hunch to plan the application maintenance. So he meets the network admin Neil, and he's requesting for this information. And this information might not be available real time, and there may be a need to fetch this information through script on the ADC. And then he meets another app admin for the procurement app, who suggests that since every application is different, Adam should use his application's lean usage analytics behavior to understand what is the lean usage period and decide on the maintenance likewise. So Adam uses ADM lean usage analytics. On the app dashboard, he goes to the app dashboard, uses the key metrics section, and sees that the Saturday 4 p.m. to 5 p.m. is the most lean usage period of SharePoint application. The second most lean usage period is Sunday 3 a.m. to 4 a.m. That's how he understands the lean usage period of his application, and he takes a conscious decision of taking the application maintenance during the Sunday to have the least impact. Let's see this over a demo on the ADM service GUI. So for this, you will have to again go to the application dashboard. You can go to any particular application, go to the key metrics section. And for lean usage analytics for app maintenance decision, you need to select at least a week of data, because that's what the underlying analytics engine needs to generate this kind of insight. And this is how it will present you the various lean usage period. So as you see the color coding, darker the color indicates more usage and lighter the color indicates less usage. And it clearly numbers 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, one being the least usage period. I have different metrics to qualify as lean usage. I can use total request, throughput and data volume as well. So let me use total request, and it seems that my Saturday 11 to 12 p.m., 11 morning to 12 noon is the most lean usage period, followed by Monday morning 4 a.m. to 5 a.m. So this is based on 1 hour duration of maintenance. Let's say I have an application which needs at least 4 hours of maintenance duration. I can select 4 hours from here. So it will give me the lean usage period as Saturday morning 8 to 12 noon, followed by the second lean usage period on Saturday 12 noon to 4 p.m. So that's how you can use the ADM lean usage analytics for all your app maintenance decisions. Let's move to the last section of analytics, which is around app A plus rating analytics. So A plus rating is provided by Qualys SSL Labs, which helps you assess your SSL configuration and helps you to understand how secure is your SSL configuration. Since SSL usage is becoming widespread, it is important to pay the most attention to how it is configured. So other than assessing any kind of expired certificates, you need to assess that the configuration is appropriate and is most secure. So Qualys SSL Labs helps you to assess your SSL configuration. It gives a score of A plus to F, A plus being the most secure. It assesses configuration in areas of protocol, protocol settings, ciphers. ADC has already defined a secure front-end profile, which if bound to an application can make it A plus. So the current pain point is lack of visibility into the apps and their SSL ratings, lack of visibility into SSL configuration for apps and virtual servers, and understanding what is the gap to achieve a secure A plus rating. There is no simple way to achieve A plus rating for all the applications. And app owners rely on network admins to use individual ADCs and configure the secure front-end profile. So with ADM in a unified way, you can configure this secure front-end profile and make all the applications as A plus from one unified console. And finally, you can assess the impact on traffic after the secure profile is deployed. We can go to the ADM SSL Insight and see how is the traffic pattern changing. So this is the secure front-end profile for A+. All the older protocols need to be disabled and the newer TLS protocols need to be enabled. Protocol settings like HSTS need to be enabled and the age needs to be set. And any kind of non-secure SSL renegotiation needs to be disabled. And ADC provides four cipher alias which needs to be bound to your application and can make it A+. So it helps you to discover all your apps which are not A plus using the filter option on the ADM app dashboard. It helps you to understand current configuration gaps to achieve the A plus rating, provides a one-click deploy option to make your application as A plus, and finally assess the impact using the SSL insights after you deploy the A plus configuration on your application. So let's see this over a demo. So this is my ADM service GUI. So I'm selecting a 1 month duration and I'll filter on the apps which are not rated as not A plus. So I get an internet banking app which is rated as not A plus. When I go to the SSL tab, I see the app is not rated as A plus and I see the what constitutes the ideal secure profile. I can see there is one bound virtual server to this application. It has issues in protocol config, protocol details, and cipher suite. When I scroll down below, I can see the what are the issues and some of the recommendations. We see that TLS 1 and 1.1 is enabled, which needs to be disabled. Similarly, HSTS setting is not enabled. And there are other kind of ciphers which are bound to this application, which needs to be unbound. And one of those secure cipher groups need to be bound. Now, having this understanding, I will now click on the button to upgrade to A plus SSL rating. Once I click on that, you can see the different commands which are getting executed. And I can choose to continue. So this will execute the command using a configuration job. I will see that my app has become A plus rated and we don't have any issues with respect to the particular virtual server. We can see that it is executed through a configuration job and we can select the configuration job and see the details of the command being executed. And there are no recommendations as there are no issues. Now I can choose also to roll back this configuration. which will again revert the configuration. When I do continue, again my app will become not A plus and the same set of issues will appear again. I can see that the app has again become not A plus. So this was a short demo on how it works. This brings us to the end of this particular webinar. We have few poll questions which we would want you to respond to so that we can assess how you find these use cases. The first poll question is on the app slowness issue, how you can detect apps which are slow and identify the contributing factor. The second poll question is on the app maintenance decision using lean usage analytics. Do let us know if you find this useful for taking decisions of your application's maintenance. This poll is about A plus rating analysis and configuration. You let us know what is your feedback about this use case. And finally, let us know what do you think about the statistics of the bound monitors for your services. I think there is some issue with this poll. We couldn't capture the response. So this brings us to the end of this webinar. And do stay tuned for next month's webinar. We'll have more exciting topics. Thank you for joining and see you in next month's webinar.